I'm Bert Enstring, and I'm your teacher in this course. We are now going to look at formal relations in the network. The first thing we try to find out is what formal rules and regulations apply to windmills at sea. Checking the internet will reveal that there are at least three European guidelines with respect to construction at sea: the Birds and Habitat Guideline, the Framework Directive Marine Strategy, and Natura 2000. In the Netherlands, there are at least five laws to consider: the Law on Nature Protection, Electricity Law, the Law on Town and Country Planning, the Water Law, and the Law on Control of State Public Works. So that's a lot. We're now in the next step, and we're going to construct a map. When constructing the map on formal relations, we start with the statutory framework. Our problem owner, Economic Affairs, is responsible for the Dutch energy policy, and through one of its agencies administers the subsidies for sustainable energy. Infrastructure and Environment is responsible for planning at sea and the choice of locations. They have the Directorate North Sea responsible for this subject. When looking into more detail and checking out policy documents, we soon find additional agencies and departments within the ministries managing other subsidies and implementing European laws and regulations, for instance, relating to the EU energy law and the guidance for birds and habitat protection. But for now, we think we know enough, and we try to map the formal relations and responsibilities. And we put the two ministries on the top of our map, and by putting them in a box jointly, we show that they belong to one bigger organization. Next, the offshore wind consortia are dependent on Economic Affairs for their subsidies and on Infrastructure and Environment for the location permit and the Nature 2000 permit. Private investors and environmental organizations like Greenpeace are participating in these offshore wind consortia, and the energy companies respond to Economic Affairs on behalf of the energy law, and they need permits from the planning ministry for the installations onshore. According to the electricity law, Economic Affairs is supervising TenneT, the net coordinator, and the energy companies have intensive relations with TenneT on the offshore and the offshore consortiums. Oh, and it might, of course, be nice to put the current users of the North Sea, the fishermen and nature protection organizations, the shipping agents and others who are lobbying the ministry to protect their interests. We've now taken the first three steps in our actor analysis. We started by taking the problem formulation of our problem owner as point of departure, and we then made a long list of all the actors having influence on the problems or its potential solutions and those actors holding an interest. We have many methods for doing this. We saw how we can use a causal or systems model for finding actors, but also social science methods like position, reputation, or demographic characteristics came along. As sometimes your list is too long to reasonably work with, you may need to reduce its length and make a short list of the most relevant parties. A smart way to do this is by using a so-called stakeholder analysis technique by making a power interest grid. Then, as a third step, we map the formal relations to see what hierarchical and legislative rules apply in our case.